illusionist Derren Brown. If you feel comfortable taking part, please do so. There may be strong language.
None of the 12 participants in this séance are actors or stooges. If you want to take part in this séance, you will need a pen and paper, a wine glass, all the letters of the alphabet on separate slips of paper, or you can use Scrabble tiles, and a flat surface like a table. You'll have time to assemble these later on. Good evening. Tonight we're here at Elton Hall in East London, which until 1983 was used as a training centre for medical students, and since then it's laid abandoned in the middle of a busy street. I would ask you at home to involve yourself in this séance, and I've also invited 12 students from around the country to participate in tonight's events. Now, the 12 students were chosen by placing advertisements around different universities, and there was a particular sort of person that I was after that would most authentically replicate the sort of people that would go to Victorian séances. First of all, they had to be open-minded about the paranormal. I also held a series of suggestibility tests to choose the people I felt would be most responsive to the idea of a séance. Now, the temptation at home may be to believe these people are stooges, but they're not. They have no idea what's going to happen beyond the fact that we're going to attempt a séance. And by the end of tonight, all but one of these students will be dead. That's not true. I'd give them about a week. Séances date back to the 1800s, after three sisters by the name of Fox claimed to be able to contact the dead. They toured America with their demonstrations and attracted the rich and famous, and by the end of the century, séances had taken off all over the Western world. Spirits were manifested, tambourines flew, ectoplasm impossibly erupted from entranced mediums. Then, after 40 years of this, rather embarrassed by what they'd started, one of the sisters, Margaret Fox, confessed that they were frauds. The miracles which had started it all off had been a scam. But her confessions made very little difference, and spiritualism continues to appeal to many people today. I don't believe in spiritualism personally. I find it quite ugly, but I am interested in the sorts of techniques used by fraudulent Victorian mediums, and I'm interested to see whether these techniques can be used to affect a modern sceptical audience. So, let's go meet our guys. Hello, everybody. Hello there. Welcome to Elton Hall. Hope you enjoy your evening. Can you come through with me into this room here? Thank you. You want to sit in the first couple of rows? Okay, thank you. All right, so before we start, I just want to try something very quickly with you. What I'd like you all to do is to have in your mind the name of somebody you know who has died, somebody who's passed on, and information about that person. Really have this right in the front of your mind now. What their name was, what they looked like, what interests they had, what their relationship was to you as well. Will you all think of somebody for me? Just sort of do that now. Have that in your head. Great. Okay. And really concentrate on that person. Really have an image of... Yep, great, so I can do this with you. All right, thank you. Look at me for a second. So the person that you're thinking of, it's a lady, isn't it? Yeah. And this is somebody who died when they were fairly old, I think. And as you imagine, this is quite a shortish lady. And I think quite large... You sort of remember sort of fairly large glasses when you think back to it. Yeah. And when you think about it, something about flowers, what's that? Yeah. Something... Did she collect flowers?
She was the owner of a flower shop.
She's owned a flower shop. That's really interesting. Great. And she... it was your grandmother, yes?
Yeah.
And her name is... Laura or Nora? Noreen? Nora.
Yeah, Nora.
Nora, excellent. Yeah, thank you. Okay. All right, so what you've just seen there is a fraudulent technique used by mediums in the Victorian times. There's a trick to it, in a way. Okay? But in your head, you make it convincing, and that's what's important. And a lot of séance really is about this. You know, I am very sceptical about a lot of spiritualism, but I would ask you tonight just to join me in a spirit of open-mindedness and exploration. All right? So, let me explain why I've gathered you all here today. On February the 27th, 1974, a tight-knit clique of 12 students gathered in a room downstairs, led by this guy, Nicholas Gadd. Let me just show you that picture. I'm going to show the camera. And I'll pass it around so you can all look at it too. On a given signal from Gadd, who was a particularly charismatic member of the group, they drank between them 8 pints of bleach. It was a suicide pact. And within half an hour, they were all dead. That's all of them apart from Gadd, who survived and moved to Australia, and some years later he died in a car crash. Now, since that incident 30 years ago, there have been over 40 reports of paranormal phenomena, hauntings and sightings and so on in this building. Now, that may be no more than just coincidence and imagination. Whatever you believe, it's a little disconcerting to be here in the building where these guys lived and died. And as we do this also, I would ask you at home to really make the decision to involve yourself in tonight's experiments. There will be a number on the screen that you can call, and please do call if any strange things happen at home that you want to tell us about. Please do call. All right, so one particularly theatrical item that grew out of the Victorian séance period is the spirit cabinet. That's what this is here. All right, you can see it's fairly simple. The medium would be tied up and restrained inside the cabinet. The curtain would be closed all around. And then bizarre paranormal phenomena would occur inside the cabinet, supposedly outside of the medium's control. For example, a tambourine would move and jangle around, or spirit writing would appear on paper, supposedly from the spirits themselves. And of course, skeptics suggested there was some kind of trickery involved, and very possibly there was. So I'm going to try something tonight that hasn't been done before, and also shouldn't really be done, and that's to put essentially a member of the public in there, rather than me going in there or a medium going in there. Okay, so I'd like to try this, I think, maybe first of all with you, if I can. Is that all right? Would you want to just come around for me and come and stand here? Excellent, thank you. It's Jess, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right. You see, when you sit in that cabinet and the curtain closes, your state can absolutely just change in an instant. It's very interesting. Would you take a seat for me just there? Excellent. Thanks for doing this, by the way.
Okay.
Yeah, look at me. Yeah, I'm very happy for you now to do this yourself. Look at my hand. And you can just start to get yourself into a nice, relaxed, sort of like a trancey medium state that they used to go into, so that the spirits can just play. Excellent. Very nice. You put your hand there, and your hand there, and your feet flat on the floor. Very good. I'm going to move these around you, closing the curtains on all sides. I want you to remain in the state. Just tell me, did you move the tambourine then?
No.
Did you touch anything?
Mm-mm.
Did you even move?
No.
No. Be absolutely honest. Come back to me first of all. Just open your eyes. Just come back to me. Come back to me. Good, thank you. All right. Did you touch the tambourine?
No.
No. Did you throw it out the curtain just then?
No.
No. Sure?
Yeah.
Okay, come out for a second. Would you absolutely swear blind that you did not touch that tambourine?
I'm positive, yeah.
All right. Did you move at all?
No.
No. All right. Excellent, thank you.
Well, where's it gone?
It's over there at the moment.